Hi, everybody. It's me, Frederico. And I just wanted to share a little bit today from this awesome book that I'm reading. It's called Epic. And it's the story of what the big guy upstairs is telling. It's a story that God is telling. I believe that there's a higher power involved in all of our lives, whether we know it or not. I didn't know it for a long time. And now that I do, I want to share it. So let's start this epic journey together. I'll be reading from this book for a few minutes, and hopefully you enjoy it. You can just hit play, and when you're driving to go pick up the kids, or you're on your way to school, or you're just wanting to hear something that takes you on a little bit of adventure, then join me every Sunday, and then we'll continue to read new books. So, let's begin with a famous quote from G.K. Chesterton. I had always felt life as a story, and if there is a story, there is a storyteller. Yes, sir. I wonder what sort of tale we've fallen into. Remember that quote? It's from Lord of the Rings. J.R. Tolkien, Lord of the Rings. Samwise Gamgee says that to Frodo. I wonder what sort of a tale we've fallen into. It's been quite a journey for Frodo and Sam when they wonder about this idea of falling into a story. Ever since they left home, these little gardeners have encountered more wonders and more dangers than they could possibly have imagined. The battle on Weathertop, the flight to the ford, the beauty of Rivendell, the dark mines of Moriah, when they lost their beloved Gandalf. Their fellowship has fallen apart. Their friends are now far away on another part of the journey. Into the shadow of Mordor they've come, two little hobbits and their cooking gear, on a journey to save the world. It's at this point that Sam says that famous line, I wonder what sort of a tale we've fallen into. Sam could not have asked a better question. He assumes that there is a story. There is something larger going on. He also assumes that they have somehow stumbled into it, been swept up into it. What sort of a tale have I fallen into? Is a question that would help us a great deal if we wondered it for ourselves. It just might be the most important questions you, my friend, ever ask. Because life is a story. Life, you'll notice, really is a story. Life doesn't come to us like a math problem. It comes to us the way that story does, scene by scene. You wake up, what happens next? You don't get to know, you have to enter into it. Take the journey as it comes. The sun might be shining. There might be a tornado outside. Your friends might call and invite you to go sailing or golfing or dancing. You might lose your job. Life unfolds like a drama, doesn't it? Each day has a beginning and an end. There are all sorts of characters, all sorts of settings. A year goes by like a chapter from a novel. Sometimes it seems like a tragedy. Sometimes it seems like a comedy. Most of it feels like a soap opera. Whatever happens, it's a story through and through. All life is a story, Madeline Ligon reminds us. And this is helpful to know. When it comes to figuring out this life that you're living, you do well to know the rest of the story. You come home one night to find that your car has been totaled. Now, all you know is that you loaned it for a couple of hours to a friend or your teenage daughter. And now here it is, all smashed up. Isn't the first thing that comes out of your mouth, what happened? In other words, tell me the story. Somebody has some explaining to do. And that can be done only in hearing the tale they have to tell. Careful now. you might jump to the wrong conclusion. Doesn't it make a difference for you to know that she wasn't speeding? That in fact the other car ran a red light? It changes the way you feel about the whole thing. Thank God she's all right. The truth be told, you don't know the rest of the story if you want to understand. Truth be told, you need to know the rest of the story if you want to understand just about anything in life. You notice jokes are like that. There's nothing to them at all if you walk in on the punchline. And then she said, "That's not my dog." Everybody else is laughing hysterically. What's so dang funny? I think I missed something. Love affairs, layoffs, the collapse of empires, your child's day at school. None of it makes sense without a story. I mean, story is how we figure things out. Bring two people together and they will soon be telling stories. A child on her grandmother's lap, two men fishing in a boat, strangers stuck for an hour at a layover in an airport. Simply run into a friend. What do you want to know? How was your weekend? Fine is not a good answer. It's just not satisfying. You heard something about a mariachi band, a fifth of tequila, and a kitty cat? You want to know more about that story. I mean, look at our fixation with the news. Every morning and every evening in every part of the world, billions of people read a paper or tune in to the local news. Why? Because we humans have this craving for meaning, for the rest of the story. We want to know, we need to know what's going on. The author of this story says, our boys are ambushed somewhere in Asia. Oh, he's talking about the army. Our boys are ambushed somewhere in Asia. What's happening over there? A virus is rampaging on the internet? What do we need to know to protect ourselves? Somehow, we don't feel as lost if we know what's going on around us. We want to feel orientated to our world. When we turn on the news, we're turning in to a world of stories. Not just facts, stories. Stories are the language of the heart. After all, what's the world's favorite way to spend a Friday or Saturday night? With a story, a book, a favorite TV show, a movie, isn't that true? Golly, there's a video store on every corner. Not anymore, but when this book was written. But a TV theater, yeah. Netflix, yeah. Movies online, YouTube, yeah. There's a fixation for stories. And he talks about how, like, back when this was written, video stores replaced churches on the corner of every block, right? It goes far deeper than entertainment, by the way. Stories nourish us. They provide a kind of food that the soul craves. Stories are equipment for living. Robert McKee, a Hollywood screenwriter, says he believes that we go to movies because we hope to find in somebody else's story something that will help us understand our own. We go to live in a fictional reality that illuminates our daily reality. Because stories shed light on our lives, don't they? We might know that life is a journey, but through Frodo's eyes, we see that the journey, what it will require. We might know that courage is a virtue, but having watched Maximus as Gladiator, remember Maximus and Gladiator? Are you not entertained? Is that not why you are here? What we do in life echoes in eternity. Right? That's a great film, I love it. Or Joe March in Little Women, we find ourselves longing to be courageous. We learned all of our most important lessons in life through story. and story deepens all of our most important lessons. As Daniel Taylor has written, our stories tell us who we are, why we're here, and what we are to do. They give us our best answers to all of life's big questions and to the most of the small ones as well. This is why if you want to get to know someone, you need to know their story. Their life is a story. It too has a past and a future. It unfolds in a series of scenes over the course of time. Why is grandfather so silent? Why does he drink so much? Well, let me tell you. There was a terrible battle in World War II in the South Pacific on an island called Okinawa. Tens of thousands of Americans' men died and were wounded there. Some of them were your grandfather's best friends. He was there too, and he saw things he's never been able to forget. But in order to make you understand, explained novelist Virginia Woolf, to give you my life, I must tell you my story. I expect all of us at one time or another, in an attempt to understand our lives or discover what we ought to do, our purpose, our destiny, we've gone to someone else with our stories. This is not merely the province of psychotherapists and priests, but of any good friend. Tell me what happened. Tell me your story, and I'll try to help make sense of it. You seem stuck. Things fall apart. What does it all mean? Should we have chosen a different major after all? Were you meant to take that teaching job? Are you going to find someone to spend your life with? And will he or she remain true? What about the kids? Are they headed in the right direction? Did you miss an opportunity in their lives? Some key moment along the way? And if crucial moments are about to happen, will you recognize them? Will you miss your cues? We humans share these lingering questions. Who am I, really? Why am I here? Where will I find life? What does the big guy upstairs want of me? The answers to these questions seem to come only when we know the rest of the story. As Neo said in The Matrix, I just wish I knew what I'm supposed to do. If life is a story, what is the plot? What is your role to play? It would be good to know that, wouldn't it? What is this all about? Seeing our lives as stories is more than a powerful metaphor. It is how experience presents itself to us. We've lost our story, though. And here's the problem. For most of us, life feels like a movie we've arrived at 45 minutes late. Something important seems to be happening. I mean, good things do happen, sometimes beautiful things. You meet someone, you fall in love, you find out that work that is yours alone to fill. But tragic things happen too. You fall out of love, or perhaps the other person falls out of love with you. Work begins to feel like punishment. Everything starts to feel like an endless routine. If there is meaning to this life, then why do our days seem so random? What is this drama that we've been dropped in the middle of? What about this? If there is a God, what sort of story is he telling? At some point, we may begin to wonder if Macbeth wasn't right after all. Is life a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing? No wonder we keep losing heart. We find ourselves in the middle of a story that is sometimes wonderful, sometimes awful, often a confusing mixture of both, and we haven't a clue how to make sense of it all. It's like we're holding in our hands some pages torn out of a book. And these pages are the days of our lives, fragments of a story. They seem important, or at least we long to know what they are. But what does it all mean? If we only could find the book that contains the rest of the story. G.K. Chesterton had it right when he said, With every step of our lives, we enter into the middle of some story which we are certain to misunderstand. The world has lost its story. How that happened is quite a story as well, one we haven't time for here. But the latest chapter of that story had to do with the modern era and how mankind looked to science to solve the riddles of our lives. As Neil Postman said about the scientific view, in the end, science does not provide the answers most of us require. Its story of our origins and our end is, to say the least, unsatisfactory. To the question, how did it all begin? Or to the question, how will it all end? Science answers, probably by an accident. And to many people, the accidental life is not worth living. So since then, we've pretty much given up on trying to epic, the story that God is telling. Well, we just left off, had to take a little commercial break, but let's finish off this first chapter here. Okay, there is a larger story. Walk into any large mall, museum, amusement park, university or hospital, and you'll typically meet at once a very large map with the famous red star and the encouraging words, "You are here." You know, these maps are offered to visitors as ways to orient themselves to their situation, get some perspective on things. This is the big picture. This is where you are in that picture. Hopefully now you know where to go. You have your bearings. Oh, that we had something like this for our lives, hey friends? This is the story in which you have found yourself. Here's how it got started. Here's how it went wrong. Here's what will happen next. Now this is the role you've been given. If you want to fulfill your destiny, this is what you must do. These are your cues, and here is how things are going to turn out in the end. We can know. We can discover the story. Maybe not with perfect clarity, maybe not in the detail you'd like, but in greater clarity than most of us now have. And that would be worth the price of admission, would it not? I mean, to have some clarity would be gold right now, wouldn't it? Start with the movies we love. Start with the movies you love. I'm serious. Think about your favorite movies. Notice that every good story has the same ingredients. Love.
Adventure.
Danger.
Heroism.
Romance. Sacrifice. The battle of good and evil. Unlikely heroes, insurmountable odds, and a little fellowship in the hope beyond hope that pulls through in the end. Am I right? Think about some of the favorite movies out there. Sense and Sensibility, Don Juan DeMarco, Titanic, The Sound of Music, Sleepless in Seattle, Gone with the Wind, Braveheart, Gladiator, Rocky, Top Gun, Apollo 13, great movies. The Matrix, Lord of the Rings. The films that you love are telling you something very important, something essential about your heart. Most of us haven't stopped to ask ourselves, now, why that heart? Why those longings and desires? Might we have been given our longings for love and adventure, for romance and sacrifice as kind of a clue, a treasure map to the meaning of life itself? Next, I want you to notice that all the great stories pretty much follow the same storyline. Things were once good. Something awful happened, and now a great battle must be fought, or a journey must be taken. At just the right moment, which feels like the last possible moment, a hero comes and sets things right. And life is found once again. It's true of every fairy tale, every myth, every Western, every epic, just about every story you can think of, one way or another. Braveheart, Titanic, Star Wars, Gladiator, Lord of the Rings, they pretty much follow the same storyline. You ever wondered why? Every story, great and small, shares the same essential structure, because every story we tell borrows its power from a larger story. A story woven into the fabric of our being. What pioneer psychologist Carl Jung tried to explain as archetype, or what his most recent popularizer Joseph Campbell called myth. All of these stories borrow from the story, from reality. We hear echoes of it through our lives. Some secret written on our hearts. A great battle to fight. And someone to fight for us. Adventure. Something that requires everything we have. Something to be shared with those we love and need. There is a story that we just can't seem to escape. There is a story written on the human heart. There's a book, as Ecclesiastes says, the big guy upstairs, God, whatever you deem God to be, your higher power, he has placed eternity in our hearts. Look, wouldn't it make sense that if we ever did find the secret to our lives, the secret to the universe, it would come to us first as a story? Story is the very nature of reality. Like the missing parts of a novel, it would explain these pages we are holding, the chapters of our lives. Second, it would speak to our heart's deepest desires. If nature makes nothing in vain, then why the human heart? Why those universal longings and desires? The secret simply couldn't be true unless it contained the best parts of the stories that you and I love. Yet, it would also need to go deeper and higher than any of them alone. Now, that takes us to what this book is about. Epic. Don't get thrown off by this, friends. Christianity claims this for us. Not the Christianity of proper church attendance and good manners. Not the Christianity of holier-than-thou self-righteousness and dogmatism. Not another religion, thank God. That is not Christianity. Oh, I know that's what most people, including the majority of Christians, think that Christianity is all about. But they're wrong. There's more. There's a lot more. And that more is what most of us have been longing for most of our lives. A story. An epic. Something hidden in the ancient past. Something dangerous now unfolding. Something waiting in the future for us to discover. Some crucial role for you and for me to play. Christianity, in its true form, tells us that there is an author and that he's good. The essence of all that is good and beautiful and true, for he is the source of all these things. It tells us that he has set our heart's longings within us. For he has made us to live in an epic. It warns that the truth is always in danger of being twisted and corrupted and stolen from us, because there is a villain in the story who hates our hearts and wants to destroy us. It calls us up into a story that is truer and deeper than any other, and assures that we will find the meaning of our lives. What if? What if all the great stories that have ever moved you, brought you joy or tears, what if they are telling you something about the true story into which you were born, the epic into which you have been cast? We won't begin to understand our lives, friends, or what this so-called gospel is that Christianity speaks of, until we understand the story in which we find ourselves in. For when you were born, you were born into an epic, a story that's already been underway for quite some time. It's a story of beauty and intimacy and adventure, a story of danger and loss and heroism and betrayal. It is a world of magic and mystery, of deep darkness and flickering light. It is a world where terrible things happen, and wonderful things too. It is a world where goodness is pitted against evil, love against hate. It is a world where order is against chaos, in a great struggle where often it is hard to find, it is hard to be sure who belongs to which side because appearances are endlessly deceptive. And it closes with this. And yet, for all its confusion and wildness, it is a world where the battle goes ultimately to the good, who live happily ever after, and where in the long run, everybody, good and evil alike, becomes known by his true name. That is the fairy tale of the gospel, with, of course, one crucial difference from all other fairy tales, which is that the claim made for it is that it's true. And that's not only happened once upon a time, but has kept on happening ever since, and is happening still. That was a quote from Frederick Buchner. But I'm rushing ahead, aren't I? Let's discover the epic for ourselves. So thus, today, that concludes the prologue of this great little story. I will be reading from this every Sunday, so tune in next Sunday. We're going to start chapter 1, act 1. And to sum it all up, we are going to go on an epic journey. Life, for most of us, feels like a movie. We've arrived at 45 minutes late. Sure, good things happen, sometimes beautiful things, but tragic things happen too. What does it all mean? We find ourselves in the middle of a story that is sometimes wonderful, sometimes awful, sometimes a confusing mixture of both, and we haven't a clue of how to make sense of it all. No wonder we keep losing heart. We need to know the rest of the story, my friends. When you were born in the middle of a great story, begun before the dawn of time. A story of adventure and of risk and of loss and heroism and betrayal. A story where good is warring against evil. Danger lurks around every corner. Glorious deeds wait to be done. Think of all those stories you've ever loved, right? There's a reason that they stirred your heart. They've been trying to tell you about the true epic ever since you were young. There is a larger story. And you have a crucial role to play. God love you. May the big guy upstairs bless you. And I'll see you next Sunday. And we continue the journey into Epic. What a great book. All right. Have a great week.